Hachette Audio presents Missing Person, written by Sarah Lotz, read by Gearoid Kavanagh, Nick Landrum, Katherine Fenton, and Lisa Rost-Welling.
If he doesn't approach me, I'll leave him alone. Pete had been watching the boy for an hour now. The kid was blonde, slight, couldn't be more than 20, couldn't be more out of place in this bar, with its leather-skinned career drinkers bundled up in work shirts and steel-capped boots. The boy had blown in out of the cold a while back, blue-lipped, shivering, hands cupped beneath his armpits, his jeans and pink denim jacket scant protection against the blizzard raging outside. But it hadn't taken long for the boy to regain his mojo. Shaking off the chill, he'd made for the bar, slid onto a stool like he owned the place. Unself-conscious, unconcerned at the glances, not all friendly, that were shot his way. Pete's neighbor, a racist asshole who'd been knocking back Boilermakers, started droning on about the Million Man March. Pete nodded along, but his eye kept being drawn to the boy. A magnetic pull that he'd given up fighting. Something had woken up inside him. Something had uncoiled, flickered to life. If he doesn't approach me, I'll leave him alone. Every so often, the boy slid off his bar stool and weaved over to one of the tables, where he tried to engage the patrons in conversation. All he'd gotten so far, apart from a cigarette and a good-natured grope from a female barfly, were shaken heads and rude gestures. It was unclear what he was saying to the folks he approached. The bartender was into Kenny Rogers and was blasting that shit out loud, but he couldn't be soliciting sex. This part of town would be the last place you'd come for that, unless you were blind or stupid. Could be that he was asking for a ride. Could be he was asking for a handout. Fucking queer, a guy pinballing his way to the men's room mouthed as he passed the kid, but it was a half-hearted jibe. It was late, and everyone had reached the maudlin stage of the evening. There was no sense of suppressed violence here, and the boy had picked up on this. This time, when the fellow he'd been hassling waved him away, the boy flipped him the bird, then sauntered back to the bar. The tables nearest the door emptied one by one, and the bartender started upending chairs, nodding along to just dropped in. Time was running out. The boy made for the payphone. He dug out a clutch of coins, dropped them in, dialed. He was gripping the handset too tightly. He hung up, rested his forehead against the wall, shrugged, and then returned to his seat. The kid may be in trouble, but he still had that thing, that inner self-assurance that no amount of hardship could fully extinguish. That thing she'd had. It was in every fluid movement. Pete's neighbor belched, slapped a dirty dollar onto the counter, then stumbled out. The boy looked over, downed his drink, caught Pete's eye, smirked, hesitated. If he doesn't approach me, I'll leave him alone. The boy approached.
Part 1. Missing. Wicklow Boy, 22. Sean learned the bizarre truth about his uncle in a cemetery on a damp October evening. Later, when he was back in the safety of his room, he'd think, with a certain amount of grim irony, that of all the places to hear that a relative had come back from the dead, a graveyard had to be the most apposite. Up till then, the day had dragged. The bookshop may as well have had tumbleweeds blowing through it. The weather and recession had chased the tourists away, and after doing the returns, Sean had spent the time playing spider solitaire and thumbing through the new releases. He was an expert at turning the pages without creasing a spine. The nights were drawing in, and he decided to lock up early. Maureen, his boss, would never know. She was thousands of miles away in Australia helping her daughter deal with the latest in a long line of personal crises, and had left him in charge. And besides, it was Thursday. He'd always left early on Thursdays to visit his mother. He cashed up, then went into the office at the back of the store to collect Daphne, who, despite being safely ensconced in her basket, had somehow managed to shed all over the latest batch of Michael Connelly's. She perked up as he shook her lead, then whined with impatience as he buttoned up his great coat. As he was locking up, Terry, who ran the cafe next door, bustled out to waylay him. His heart sank. Terry's tongue was hinged at both ends. He might never get away.
"There was a man hanging around the shop earlier, Sean. When you took the dog out at lunchtime, asked after you."
"A customer?"
"Couldn't say. Didn't like the look of him, but..."
Sean wasn't surprised. Terry didn't like the look of anyone, Sean included. He was always screwing his mouth into a disapproving cat's arse whenever they ran into each other. Could it have been Brendan? Doubtful. Brendan was paranoid about anyone spotting them together, and only communicated by text message.
"There was something rough about him," Terry continued.
"Rough how?"
"Stank of drink. And you should have seen the hair on him. Looked like Elvis's dead brother come back to life. You know someone like that? I haven't seen him around the town before."
"God no, did he say what he wanted?"
"He didn't." "You don't owe anyone any money, do you?"
Sean bristled at the question.
"No."
He was behind in one of Daphne's vet bills, but they'd hardly sent the bailiffs around for that. There was always the possibility that someone from his past, a spectre from the murky lost months, might appear. There was always that dread. Daphne was straining at her leash, and Sean let the dog drag him away. Terry and his intrusive questions could get stuffed. He and the dog usually walked the 2 kilometres to Ratnew, but the cemetery closed early in October, so today they took the bus. When they were safely through the gates, he let Daphne off the lead and headed for his mother's plot at the end of the family row. It was a fair walk. An early death was part of the Ryan legacy, along with odd-shaped ears and a smoking habit, and his relatives had colonised the place like bindweed. Sean dug out the moss between the stones. It was a soothing, mindless task, and one he looked forward to. While Daphne did her business on the grass next to his grandparents' dual plot, Sean lit a vogue and leaned towards the headstone to exhale. Bringing his dead mother a nicotine fix had become a weekly ritual, daft as it was. Not only daft, costly. It had got him back on the cigarettes again, and the habit was eating into his escape fund. At least he hadn't yet resorted to talking to her. A cough, then, "Oh yeah." Sean started, looked up to see a man approaching. A shoe polished black quiff and a skin so white he could have rolled off an embalmer's table. Reddish stubble sparked his jaw, and he was tugging on a roll-up like it was his sole source of oxygen. The hair was a dye job, and a poor one at that. There were black smudges around his ears. Must be the man who was hanging around the shop. Terry's description was spot on. Had he followed him here? Sean stood and weighed up the situation. There was no real aura of threat coming from the fellow, but Sean's radar for trouble jangled all the same. He whistled for the dog in case he had to make a hasty getaway. As usual, Daphne ignored him.
"Were you at the bookshop earlier?"
"I was. Place was locked up, and some nosy arse kept eyeing me up, so I left."
"Did you want to see me about something?" The man jabbed his cigarette at the headstone.
"That what killed her."
"You what?"
"The fags. That what killed her. Saw what you were doing. Good of you to do that. Eileen always liked the smoke."
"You knew my mother?"
"I did. I couldn't believe it when I heard she passed over. Must have been hard for you losing her so young."
He sniffed and swatted a hand under his nose. There was a slur in his voice, and he stood with his feet apart, weaving slightly.
"Had a mouth on her, didn't she? She was always back-chatting the teachers at school. Always gave as good as she got."
"There was no way you were in school there." Sean had every right to be dubious. His mother was 32 when she died, and judging by Elvis's jowls and sunken eyes, he wouldn't see 50 again.
"Nah, but I used to knock about with your uncle."
"Donnie?"
"Not that cunt. Teddy. You're the spit of him, you know that?"
"I've heard that before."
"Bet you have. Knew you had to be Eileen's kid the second I saw you in the town. It was like going back in time."
The man wiped a hand on his jeans and held it out.
"John McKenna. Johnny."
Sean didn't recall his mother mentioning anyone called Johnny. but after a hesitation, he reached out. Johnny's palm was hot, and he was giving off the sour milk stink of the dedicated drinker. Sean.
Good to meet you. Was it cancer that took her?
Aneurysm.
That's too bad. Sorry, son. Sorry.
The breeze tickled Sean's fringe, but Johnny's pompadour remained impervious.
She was full of life when I knew her, full of spark. Wish I could have made it to the wake, only I'd been away.
Is that why you wanted to see me? Because of my mother?
Just wanted a word.
About what? Sean waited for the request for cash. Johnny looked the type to use any tenuous connection to hit someone up for a loan. Daphne deigned to return and sniffed at Johnny's shoes. Two-tone winkle pickers that poked like knives from the bottom of his turnips. Before Sean could warn him, he stooped to pat her. She snapped at him, but he barely reacted. Sean clipped the lead onto her collar and yanked her to heel. Sorry, she doesn't like men.
Well, who can blame her? What's her name?
Daphne. A snort.
Daphne. No wonder she's got one on her.
Specks of ash fell from his fingers as he crushed the roly.
Daphne. An old girl, is she? Got some grey in her muzzle there.
12. She was my mother's dog.
All right. Eileen was mad for animals, always bringing in the strays. Daphne a stray?
She was. Aaron from Sean's old estate had found Daphne running loose in Rathnew, the dog's ears a mess of cigarette burns, but couldn't keep her as she clashed with Beyonce, Aaron's German shepherd. To save Daphne from euthanasia, his mother had taken her on, and now she was Sean's, or Sean was hers, depending on how you look at it. Beyonce was long gone, but Daphne had clung on, a small mutt who resembled a rusty wire brush on legs, her eyes now clouded with cataracts.
Eileen had a good heart, son. A good heart.
Greedy as he always was to hear tales about his mother, Sean was still picking up a dodgy vibe from Johnny that had nothing to do with the man's dress sense.
I'd better get back. Gotta feed the dog. Nice meeting you.
He moved away.
Did Teddy come back for Eileen's funeral?
Johnny called after him.
What?
Did he pitch up for the wake, like?
Was the man messing with him? The light was fading fast and Sean couldn't read Johnny's eyes. Maybe he didn't know.
Teddy died 20 years ago.
The family's still sticking to that story, aren't they?
What?
The story, son. That your uncle died in an accident. Where was it again?
Galway.
That's it. He didn't die, son. They lied to you.
Are you trying to be funny?
Teddy didn't die. He left. He's in New York. It was the last time I heard from him anyway. That would have been around 95 or so. Could be anywhere now.
You're talking bollocks.
Intent on another sniff at those shoes, Daphne fought Sean's attempts to drag her away. He gathered her into his arms. He'd deal with the dog hair later.
You seen his grave then, have you? Got a death certificate.
I'm not listening to this shite. But all the same, a splinter of doubt niggled. Sean ignored it and picked up the pace.
He's not dead. I'm not messing with you. Ask your auntie Janice. Ask Donnie. See if you can get the truth out of them. Teddy's out there somewhere. You should track him down.
Sean broke into a jog, only risking a glance over his shoulder when he reached the cemetery gates. Johnny was a distant, unsteady silhouette. There was a relief as he hit the pavement, then irritation that he'd ignored his instincts and engaged the man in conversation. Daphne sighed and tucked her head into the crook of his arm. She loved being carried, though it was her due. And now he'd set the precedent. She'd only drag her heels if he put her down. A soft rain began to fall, turning the oncoming car lights into golden blurs. Sean slowed and let his mind pick at the mental splinter. He and his mother hadn't been to see Teddy's grave, but he was certain they'd planned to go when he was younger. Why hadn't they gone in the end?
Money issues, probably.
They never went anywhere. And why was he giving credence to the words of a man who looked like he'd happily drink booze out of a banshee's bollocks? A gush as a bus choked with condensation whooshed past. It would be 20 minutes till the next one. He'd have to walk it. Arms aching from carrying Daphne.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.